Let's talk about expectations. Hey, everyone, and welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. In today's podcast, we're going to talk about expectations. This podcast was requested by my partner. He wanted me to do a review of asking women about male income, what is enough? And it's a video that you might know from like Steven's channel or other YouTubers have definitely covered it. But I thought this would be a really great conversation to be had because when I saw clips from these women, I just kept thinking they really don't know what they're asking for. I just kept thinking there's no way they understand what they're asking for. So I thought it'd be really good to go over it and see if we could maybe have some compassion in relation to their misconception of expectations, and then we could use it to reflect upon ourselves. So let's jump into this bubble. This channel is called Courtney Ryan. I assume it's one of the main women who owns the channel or something, and then we'll go into it.
So my expectations are not realistic.
I don't want a Hugh Hefner, trust me. I'd rather just be single. Thank you, though.
Well, somebody's gonna have a sugar mama.
If your wife can spend more than you make, like, you need to make more money, so.
I was just having this conversation.
I'm sorry, pause already. I'm sure we're gonna come into her interview, but when she said, like, if your wife can spend more than you can make, right? Can we all do that? Like, girl, if you got $10 in your bank account and the thing you want costs $15, all you gotta do is, you know what I'm saying? Can we all overspend? It's kitschy, though. It's kitschy, right? Like, if you can outspend what your husband makes, he needs to make more. That's like a super kitschy Instagram, like, kind of hashtag. But that's just called, like, a lack of discipline and overspending, girls.
If my friend, and she was like, you have to manifest a husband, girl.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back to my channel. If you're new here, I'm Courtney Ryan. And today, we have a group of girls back with us. If you've never seen any of these girl videos that I've done in the past, what I do is bring on other women to get other women's perspectives. If you guys are a subscriber to my channel, you probably know where I stand on a lot of these topics. I have 400 videos covering my thoughts and opinions. But I think it's really enlightening and interesting to get the opinion of other women who maybe don't have a platform or who, you know, maybe don't talk about these topics or even think about these topics, and we're gonna get through this together. So let's get started. What
I like
is the
her.
Ideal age for a guy beautiful. That you are looking to be with?
So I just turned 27, so like 3 years older than that. So I would say between like 31, maybe 32, just depending on like when their birthday is.
So I'm 27, and I would say I would want them to be older. So like my like range that I look for is 28 to 35.
I think anyone within 3 to 5 years, either way, but probably older. Yeah.
I will say I'm 33 and my preference is 5 years younger or 5 years older. I don't really find myself being very attracted to people that are quite younger than that, because if I'm 33, that means like 28 and 38, basically, right? I don't really find like guys in their 40s or women in their 40s very dateable. I find them super attractive. Don't get me wrong. Super attract, but not dateability. And then same when they're too young, it's like, well, I'm already in my 30s. I'm basically 35. I'm going to be 34 soon. Like, you know, I'm already in my mid-30s. So it's kind of like, I don't want to date someone in their mid-20s. It's just like, we're not even in the same, like, we're not having the same experiences at that point, you know?
Okay, so maybe 33?
Potentially.
If you had to choose?
There's a lot of mature, this is just recently, there's a lot of mature people at the end of their 20s who I think I have good chemistry with, so I wouldn't like. And then there's people in their 30s, even in their early 30s, who act like they're so, like, they got a bum knee and stuff. And I'm like, okay, but, like, I don't feel broken yet. You can't
I feel
go
broke.
For a run with me. Just, like, go down.
No, I think that's, like, really fair. I am broken. I woke up this morning in so much, like, fucking physical pain. Mostly, I think I'm having a bad lupus day. Like, my skin's really patchy. I'm a little freaking out about it because my, like, I'm very patchy today. And my back is killing me. Like, my body is a wreck today. And a part of me is just like, oh, my God, I'm so old. Like, am I ever going to have kids? Like, what am I even doing here with my life? So I kind of feel her. Like, it would, if somebody was dating me and they're like, hey, I'm very active, I'd be like, for your sake, you have to break up with me.
I want to wait at the gym. I don't get it. So I don't know. It's hard.
Okay. Do we want to go somewhere in the middle? Maybe 30.
Yeah.
Okay. 30. Yeah. We'll just go with your age.
I really like 28 to 36 max, or like 37 max. Like, not in the 40s.
Like, I like her sweater.
Still in the 30s, because I feel like they've matured. They kind of have gotten settled in their careers. They know what they want. They're not really looking, there's less of a chance that you'll find somebody who like is just looking to play games.
Okay, and how old are you?
I'm gonna be 24 in November.
Okay.
So you're why do all these young girls want older people? When I was in my early 20s, I mean, I definitely was fucking people who were 38, whatever. I definitely was dating. When I was 24, I was dating a 37, 38-year-old. But he was so immature. It was basically like dating a 25-year-old. Like, I got none of the perks of dating someone older because he didn't have any of the perks of dating someone older. You know what I mean? Like, in my head, if you're dating someone older, maybe they have their shit together more. But yeah, I was dating somebody older, but he did not have his shit together.
I'm pretty young.
By the time this video comes out, you'll be 24. Okay. So if we have to pick one age, you said between 28 and 36, what did we say, like 32?
Yeah, I would say 30. No, 30? Probably like 30 is perfect to meet them. And then we can get married when they're like 32.
I feel
okay, that's
like
not too much of a distance.
Bracket that I'm normally looking at, or the roster, I guess. I don't know, between like 29 and like, I don't know, 37, 38, I guess, because I just feel like all guys that are honestly between 24 to 28, they don't really want anything serious at all.
I would say 27.
Okay, and how old are you?
23.
I would have to say the person that I would marry right now would probably have to be between 32 and maybe 43.
Okay.
Between like 30 and 40s. Yeah, I'm 28.
Okay, so no, that makes sense. I'm sorry. I thought I heard wrong.
I feel like the person I'm with needs to be a lot more mature than me.
Okay. So do we want to go like 37? Just to go somewhere in the middle?
Yeah, I would definitely be with a 37-year-old.
Okay. So we'll take that as the number.
Okay.
Thinking of your future, what percent of the family income do you personally want to contribute? Like, do you want to be the breadwinner? Do you want to contribute 50-50? Do you want to be a stay-at-home wife or mom?
I would be comfortable contributing 50-50, okay. But I would prefer that it be more so like 40-50.
Okay. Like me 40-60. Like you, yeah. The 40, them the 60.
Yes.
I'd be okay with, you know, I never thought of this. I don't know. These weren't the things that I fixated on the most when I envisioned my partner. But if I had to throw it out there, like maybe half or a little under half. Okay. I'm probably,
we'll go 50-50 top.
Yeah.
Okay, this girl is so pretty. Okay, a few things. The first thing that sticks out to me, at least, is when I'm thinking about this, I have to make the assumption that a lot of them know their career paths and probably know how suitable of a breadwinner they can be. Versus like in my relationship, I've already consented to being the breadwinner. So I'm contributing 100% of the income to my household. And then along the way, if we don't have kids, then of course he'll work, because like what else would he do with his time? But in general, if we're going to have kids, like I'm not going to become the stay-at-home mom like he will, unless for some reason he thinks like, oh, I'd like to make more money and I'm going to choose a career path that would make us more money. Then yeah, like we can switch roles or whatever. But I think I'm assuming these people are taking into consideration their career paths. I know I have friends that like won't buy houses, won't settle down in cities. They're waiting for a partner because they know they want to be the primary breadwinner. That's so interesting to me. I knew guys who didn't want to date some of my girlfriends because they weren't making a lot. Even though they had really cool careers, they were like making, let's say, $25,000 to $35,000 a year. The men were worried that they wouldn't have the dual income to like live in Los Angeles or live in New York or live in these very expensive cities. So I think a lot of the time when we think about like how much our man should make or our partner should make or our women should make, we're really asking ourselves like, what lifestyle do you think you're going to have, right? Plenty of Americans are perfectly happy on $60,000 a year, no biggie, right? $70,000 a year is a great income. $80,000 is a great income. Hell, even $45,000 in certain states could be a great income. So it's really not a matter of how much, it matters what lifestyle you think you're going to have. But I have to assume these women are taking into consideration their own career paths. Like, it's actually quite interesting. If you have a relationship in which you have a lifestyle in mind, and then you go turn to your partner who's making the only income and say, hey, I have this in mind for my life, make it happen. I might slap a bitch with that kind of attitude, you feel? Like, I might slap a bitch. Could you imagine your partner's coming to you, the person who's supposed to love you more than anyone in the world, and they go, hey, I want a yacht, so what is this attitude I see in some people? Now, I'm not seeing that in anyone right now, but what I am hearing is sort of, let me rephrase. What I would like to hear is I wish you would ask them what they do for a living and why they want to be the less earner. Because maybe she'll cover it, actually. We're only like 5 minutes in, so let's keep going. Oh. This girl is literally, she's like a flawless human. You know what I'm saying? You ever just like see someone and you're like, I could never be that beautiful. Like, holy crap. Not in a bad way. Like, not in a demoralizing way. I'm a beautiful Middle Eastern goddess. But this woman here, whoo.
Ooh. So I personally, I would not mind contributing like majority, but I would say no more than 70% of household income.
So I really want to be a stay-at-home mom. So like, if that doesn't work out with the person I'm with, then it doesn't work out. But that is like how I picture myself as a mom and a wife. So I guess I wouldn't be contributing financially.
Does that make any of you guys feel bad? Like, could you leave a comment section in the sections down below and tell me if you feel bad thinking that you might not contribute? Obviously, if you're a stay-at-home parent, you're going to have a lot of responsibility that I think is really important that you pay attention to the details in. Like, I fully expect my husband to pay an extreme amount of detail to raising our children or having a life together. I know him and I have talked about the possibilities, like, of what if I'm too tired to have kids? What if I'm too sick to have kids? You know, what if we don't have kids? What will we do? We'll probably like travel and do all these other things. A second income would really fucking help. A second income would help with kids as well, but it wouldn't really work out because a nanny could cost anywhere from $40K for a full-time nanny to $20K for a part-time nanny. So that's just like income. I remember I nannied professionally in Seattle. Many of you guys know I nannied before I did YouTube full-time. And I had this couple I was nannying for who lived in like a $1 million home that their parents had gifted them. And the wife was like hardcore feminist, worked in academia, worked for the university. She made okay money. And I remember telling her, because her child was a huge psychological problem. Like, it was insane how much this 3 to 4 year old was insane, tried to kill her little sister. It was a big deal. Anyways, I asked the father, I said, hey, like, either I get a raise or you get extra help in this house with this child's out of control. And they were like, well, you know, he works basically just to pay your salary as it is. I was like, what do you mean? I was like, your salary, they told me that my salary was paid by him working full-time basically. And I sat there and I was like, this is not good. Like, you should just be a stay-at-home dad so your child has like consistency. But if he did that, then he'd give up his trajectory in his career, which would continue on once his kids were in school. So I know a lot of us are juggling sort of like, what happens when our kids go to school? We're going to need our full-time careers back. Or, you know, maybe I can be a stay-at-home parent and I can be somebody who's, you know, really involved, like from education to taking them to school to doing after sports activities to feeding everybody. Like, that's a big full-time commitment, right? So what do you guys think? Like, when you think of a stay-at-home parent, how much responsibility do you think you'll have? If you're a stay-at-home parent and your partner works, do you still expect them to do chores? You know what I mean? Like, don't get me wrong. If my partner's completely stay-at-home and then I'm working, obviously I expect to do maybe 10% of the chores. I don't know. We'd have to talk about it. But I would do things naturally. Like, I'd want to clean my bathroom. It's like zen. I want to clean my shower. But in general, yeah, maybe I would have an expectation of doing basically no chores at that point. Because like, if you're not working, what are you doing with your free time, boo-boo? You know what I'm saying? You know, this isn't like a vacation time where you've got a sugar mama and you can just be like, because like, you don't think I want that? You know what I'm saying? So it really has to be a conversation.
I don't want any of my income to be needed in the family. I want the man to be 100% the supporter, but that doesn't mean that I'm not going to work and I'm not going to have my own business or whatever. I just...
But you would want the family to be able to live solely off of your husband's income.
Yes, 100% solely off of my husband. I don't want me to have to use my income at all, but that's not because I'm not going to be working or I'm not going to have my own stuff going on. It's just because I want the freedom to be to be able to take care of my kids for the first like 7 years of their life. I want to be a stay-at-home mom and be with them basically 24/7.
Okay, so you see how she's like thinking into the future. She's being considerate and thoughtful. She is thinking about, not that she doesn't want to contribute, but hey, am I going to be a stay-at-home mom or am I going to be a contributor, you know, to the income? I think this is pretty based. I also really love her sweater. She's very pretty. But like, I like this thought process because it's considering how much am I going to be with my children. When I was a full-time nanny, especially for this single mom who was a doctor, really nice lady, I would take that baby everywhere. Doctor's appointments, everything. I worked 7 to 7, 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. I was with that baby all the time. And I think one of the most important things that I learned is just how much goes into taking care of that baby, how much time gets spent with that baby. You know what I'm saying? It takes a lot. And so it does feel like 24/7, even though it's not. It can feel that way until the kids go to school, which is, I assume, that 7 year mark is like when they go to kindergarten, right?
I think that's important in the family structure. So that's pretty much the only reason why.
Okay, so you would choose stay-at-home mom. So 0%, we'll say.
Yes.
Okay.
I think 50-50 is definitely acceptable, and that's what I'd enjoy. I wouldn't enjoy feeling like someone has to take care of me. I don't like relying on people or men or really anyone for money. I think that's totally just unacceptable. That's just how
very egalitarian feminist.
If I'm painting a picture, if it's my ideal life, I would love to just be a stay-at-home wife with some hobbies and, you know, raising a family, because that's just the way I grew up. You know, I had a stay-at-home mom and it was just a really good environment to have.
Okay, fair. Okay,
so ideally that's what you would want.
100%. Yeah.
Okay. Now, question, because I wonder like how many of these women, because like if you're getting a job, if you're working a career, if you're getting an education, you're basically spending all of that time planning. Let's say you're getting, let's say you're like 19 and you're not sure if you're going to be a stay-at-home mom or not. It's kind of like, how do you choose what career to have until then? Because you still have to find that partner that wants to support you for the rest of your life. Like, think about it. Being a stay-at-home mom is an amazing job. It's like so beautiful. I really want my partner to be able to be a stay-at-home dad if he wants to be, if we have kids, right? I really think that's important. But, like, I guess this is only if the marriage fails. But, yeah, like, what if you raise your kids for 20, 30 years and then the marriage dissolves and then you don't have any backups? Like, that seems silly to me in some ways. Like, I always, thank God my parents are still together, because I think about my mom trying to socialize with normies, like, outside of her bubble. And I'm like, my mom would go crazy in a corporate office. Like, she would just lecture all the women about how they're not dressing appropriately. Like, you know what I mean? Like, my mom wouldn't fare in the market. She'd have to probably work for a church or something. But I think it's really important to consider, like, your future. What if your partner becomes disabled? What if they get in an accident? What if they can't perform their job? I think about that all the time. My partner has a really good resume. He, like, has been in the same career for many years. So if he ever has to default back into his career, he absolutely can. And we want to keep his education going. I'm kind of secretly hoping we do move to Europe so he can go to school full-time for basically free. I'm hoping that he can have a few backups of a career option in case, God forbid, something does happen. What if my lupus gets so bad? Or what if something else occurs? What if I have kidney failure and I have to be out of work for 4 months and I can't take calls? What if I can't do YouTube? You know, we have to think about those things, not just like a savings. Remember, we are living in the wild, wild west, boo-boos. We just have iPhones now. We just have, you know, fashion now. We just have internet now. But it really is the wild, wild west. There's no guarantee of support. There's no guarantee of anything. And so you really have to be cognizant of your preparedness. You have to be considerate of your partners. So I always want my partner to have a backup. I do not want them to not have a backup. My sister-in-law, before she married my farm brother, she was like working at a restaurant as a hostess and basically was just doing it until she met her husband. She's really lucky she met him before 25, because if she came from a family where she'd have to like figure her shit out, or if she even came from my family where like you're basically kicked out if you don't follow enough of the rules, you know what I mean? Like, what would she have done? And even now, I can see in her that she never really worked a job or never had a real responsibility of finances. It shows in the ways that she thinks about money. Like, she was like, kind of like, well, why can't we make like 30,000 more monies? And I was like, girl, you think you would just like wish 30,000 more into your bank account? I think it is just clear when people haven't been working. I think it shows. You know what I'm saying?
I want to talk about your ideal lifestyle. Okay. So thinking about a house, how many bedrooms, how many square feet? What are we thinking?
I mean, I don't need anything, you know, crazy spacious, but I definitely do want a big enough home where everybody can have their own, you know, individual selves and space to feel.
Just for the record, I grew up with 10 kids in my family. When my two older brothers went to the military and they left, my parents had a, we downsized from a house in Orange County that was 5-bedroom, 3-bath to a country home because my dad's business moved. My dad owns a business. He's an immigrant. He's from Iraq. In case you don't know our background, my parents are both from Iraq, blah, blah, blah. We downsized to a 1,500 square foot house with 5 acres, 3-bedroom, 2-bath, 6 boys in 1 room with 3 bunk beds and 2 girls in 1 room with a bunk bed. And we really liked it. Yes, there was a lot of fighting, cohabitating, living. When we lived in the Orange County house and we had the 5 bedrooms, after my two older brothers moved out, there was 2 bedrooms upstairs and kind of like a cool, like secluded area. Those were all the boys' rooms. And then the downstairs, there was 2 bedrooms plus the master bedroom, and the girls each had their own room. So for a small amount of time, I did have my own room, anime posters from literally like floor to ceiling. Thank you. And I loved it. My sister loved it. She's very clean. I'm very cluttered. So it really worked out. But then in our teenage years, high school, middle school, her middle school, me high school, we lived in a shared bedroom, which we learned very quickly how different we are. And yes, it would cause problems, but it also created a lot of problems to solve. We learned a lot of tools. We learned to problem solve together, to learn to live with somebody who is different from me. So frankly, like sharing bedrooms was really, really helpful for us as kids. But I understand the desire to have like separate bedrooms. So let's say a 4-person family in America, 2 parents, 2 kids. That's what I would love with my partner. We'd both love that. Yes, we would need, what is that, 3 bedrooms? Well, 5 if we each wanted an office, which would be ideal. So even in a 4-person family, ideally, we'd have a 5-bedroom home. So each of us could have an office and a shared bedroom, and then our kids could each have their own rooms. That's a big house. 5 bedrooms is a big house. That means I gotta make a lot more money. People, please sign up for calls. If you would like one-on-one time with Brittany, or if you would like to join my Discord for $10 a month, you can talk about philosophy and watch stuff with us. It's a lot of fun.
Comfortable, so just depending on lifestyle and family, at least 3 to 4 bedrooms for sure. 2 full baths because,
yes,
God forbid there's more than one girl in the house. That'll be
one girl. God forbid there's 8 boys. You ever seen a boy try to shave? 8 different boys try to shave their faces. Takes forever.
Drama. And definitely like a big backyard. So yeah, at least 5 acres, you know, to roam.
Oh, is. Okay. Slow down there, girlfriend. 5 acres? Where are you going to live? Oklahoma? Like, where do these people think 5 acres exist? If you get it in Cali, like, we're talking, that's $1 million property right there. So let's slow down there, chica. But in general, yeah, if you're like living in Kansas, Oklahoma, Missouri, maybe you could find property like that. But I don't know if this girl plans to live. The way she does her makeup tells me, and her hair. But then she's wearing like a country cloak or a country flannel. So maybe, hold on, this piece of hair is really driving me freaking up the wall. Anyways, it makes me wonder, like, okay, 5 acres is a big deal. Like I said, my parents have 5 acres. They bought that house at $500,000, and now it's appraised at over $1 million. But it was an old 1970s home that needed to be extremely renovated. So my parents, over 20 years, finally, after all their kids were out of the house, got a new kitchen. My dad redid the 5 acres. But that's a lot of monies, right? So, like, that's a pretty good amount of income you would need to have that kind of house. It is a ranch style because, you know, stairs is a pain. But that's an interesting statement for her to make, like 5 acres. I will tell you this. That is also a requirement of my home, is that eventually it needs to have a backyard. It doesn't matter how small the home is. I don't mind if I live in a 1,500 square foot home. Like, I'm okay with that. As long as I have acres to go outside and breathe, I can live in a tent.
What I aspire to have, and then square footage on a house, I really don't even know how to like scale something like that. I don't, like 4,000 to 5,000 square feet, maybe. Okay.
What you describe sounds close to that.
Like that, if I need to go bigger, obviously, you know, we'll go bigger. That's no question.
Do y'all know how big a 5,000 square foot house is? I've been in a house that big because I went to Beverly Hills once. No. Like, I've been to the hills, but. Girls, 5,000 square feet. Do y'all know how big of a house that is? 3,000 square feet is a huge fucking house. You want to vacuum that much house, girl? She doesn't know what that means. She genuinely does not know. She cannot know what that means. I live in a 1,700 square foot townhome right now. If this was my home with my kids, it'd be more than plenty, plus a backyard. I'd be more than happy. $5,000 is like four more of these. It's an insanely huge house. There's no way she knows what that means. And there's... Do you know how rich you have to be to afford a 5,000 square foot home? She doesn't know what that means. Okay, so now we're in a bubble where this girl who's admitting she doesn't know how to scale it has no idea what that means. That is a huge fucking house. Yeah, there's no way she knows what that means. Oh, God bless her.
Question, but just a
That's
nice
what I'm saying. These, I'm sorry. Oh, I'm going to go on a mini rant because I am the breadwinner. If you're going to make fucking requests like that, you had best date rich. Like, that is a huge fucking ask from an average person. 5,000 square feet? She does not know what that means. She has no fucking clue what that means. There's no fucking way. Like, in America? Girl, that's a very expensive house. Let me just, I gotta just, okay. So I have now looked at, so we are looking at Los Angeles. How do I show you guys? Hold on, I want to show you guys. Okay, so now... Okay, so just to give you guys an idea of what she's looking at, this is Los Angeles. I did 3-bedroom, 2-bath, all within 3 to 5,000 square feet, 4.5 milli, 1.9 milli, 2.4, 1.5, 7.6, 2.4, 4.9, 5.7, 5.9, 6.8, oh, 6.3. Okay, so let's go to, let's look at Oklahoma. Is Oklahoma cheap? Oh, Tulsa. Let's look at Tulsa. I feel like that's a cheap place to live. Okay, so with those same requirements, oh wait, yeah, no condos. Okay, same requirements. Ooh, Oklahoma's cheap. Okay, she can have this in Oklahoma. So she just can't have it in Los Angeles or New York. But look at Oklahoma. 4,000 square foot home, $599,000. Oh, okay. I know you guys can't really see because of the way that it's, whoops. Okay, that's not too bad. Like, that's cute. Okay, so this is possible in Oklahoma, maybe? Oklahoma, it's only $600,000, which is still a fuck ton. But, I mean, it's not the worst. So, okay, so it's, almost a milli, $700,000. Okay, that's not bad. Here's a million-dollar home for 4,100 square feet. That's not too shabby, actually. Oklahoma's cheap. For the same thing in Los Angeles. So, okay, so if she moves to Oklahoma... I bet she could have her dream. But again, if you're buying a $600,000 home, your partner has to have a awesome down payment. And then on top of that, they would have to be making at least, what, $150,000 a year probably, depending on the down payment. Because my dad was making $100,000 and bought a $500,000 home, but he had like $200,000 down or something. He had a pretty good amount down. So I don't know. Like, there's definitely things to be said about what you can play with the market. But at my $80,000 a year right now, I can't buy in my area for about $300,000, $400,000 because, one, I don't have the down payment that they would want. They want, like, a really good, down payment. And, two, I'm a contractor because I'm a YouTuber, so they don't count my income. It's really hard to buy a house when you're a YouTuber. I had a friend who he bought in LA for like $1 million and they had a really hard time approving his loan because he was a YouTuber, even though he could pay for it in cash. He was definitely like hard to give up $1 million. You know what I mean? Just, you know, without a loan, it's much easier to like feel, some people feel better about getting the loan. Ow. So there was definitely some of that, but because he was a YouTuber, it was really hard to get the approval.
Comfortable size home.
Okay. And then how many kids do you want?
Two to three. Great. Two boys and a girl would be ideal.
Okay. And what about a car? I know you like cars.
Oh.
Yeah. If it could be anything, you know, if it's my dream, it'd probably be a Pagani BC, which is like a hypercar, but
what is that?
I
don't even know what that
is. Oh,
that?
My gosh. They're so sexy. So that would be.
How much is that car?
I don't even know. Probably at least like 1.5 mil for sure. Oh,
it's a car. Can you imagine you have one life on earth? You spend $1 million on a car? I'm too poor for this conversation. But also, like, is that car even good for kids? What's cute about this girl, and no shade to her if she ever sees this video, she's kind of naive as fuck. She doesn't know what square footage is. She doesn't know what her favorite cars costs. She doesn't know. And this is why you might not want to be just a stay-at-home mom, because this is kind of too airheaded for me.
What about not the dream car, but
something more realistic that I would get?
Just to give us a ballpark, kind of range.
Maybe some sort of like F12 Ferrari, like an A12 Superfast would be super cool, or maybe like a 458.
Okay. How much are those?
Would be ideal. 80? No, those are probably depending, 300,000 to 525.
The audacity is too intense for me. Oh my God. This is she's freaking me out. Was she raised normal? Were you raised in a millionaire family? First of all, a Ferrari for children? What are you getting a Ferrari for when you have children? I don't even understand this conversation. $300,000 on a fucking car? Is she a fuckboy and nobody told me? Is she a family woman or not? How you want to be a stay-at-home mom and you want a Ferrari? How does this make sense? I'm saying Ferrari like this because of the movie Cars. It's so cute. Anyways, the point is, why? This is, stay-at-home mom status is like a minivan girl. Where is your SUV? Where is your minivan dreams? I am of the world, but girls, I can't wait for a family SUV. Let's go with my two kids. I want a family car, and she out here talking about Ferraris. What is going on? What kind of a stay-at-home mom is like this? This is, I grew up with very humble stay-at-home moms, very family-focused stay-at-home moms, very my children are come first stay-at-home moms. None of these answers are about her children. They're all about her. But what is she, 24, she said? Okay, that's fine.
Okay, just depending on what you go with. And
she's a car girl.
Love them.
All right, and then what about vacation? How important is travel to you?
She loves cars, but she's not willing to get a job to get one. She's going to get a husband instead. Boys, better fucking... This is outrageous. Does she even know how to keep a baby alive? This is my other thing. Y'all want to be stay-at-home moms? Are you even qualified? Can you do infant CPR? Can you do child CPR? Can you do old people CPR? Adult CPR? Can you actually care for a child? Because one time I was nannying and my baby be choking. And what I do, I took that baby and I flipped him the fuck upside down and I hit the fuck out of his back and boop, there it goes. Because you have to keep your babies alive, whether you're nannying or parenting. This girl, I don't know that I would trust her to keep a baby alive. That's what I'm saying. Y'all want a job you're not qualified for.
International.
I'm just making assumptions because she didn't know what square footage was or the kind of car she wanted. So maybe she actually knows how to really take care of kids, but
What are we thinking?
So I've not done any crazy international travels personally, but I'm always open to exploring. And I love the oceans. So
me too, girl.
French Polynesian islands would be super cool to vacay for a little while.
I'm just take me to San Diego, girl.
I don't even
I guess that's
know.
Not international.
Australia?
Though.
Something
Ooh,
like
something
that.
You'd like. Australia
yeah,
would be dope.
Absolutely. It's not a huge priority for me, but it's definitely something that is on the list.
The car is more important than the vacation.
Yeah.
So if I was a stay-at-home mom, it would be because we're financially okay without me working. And if we were in a position where that wasn't the case, then I would 100% work and be fine with that.
Love her.
But I want to have three kids, so you'd have to have a bigger house for that. So...
Not really.
I don't even know because I've never owned a home. Maybe I don't know what's normal. Is 3,000 square feet normal? That might be big.
Yeah, would you?
Now, I was raised by immigrant parents. But my parents talked to me about all this. They were not great at teaching us how to balance a checkbook. My parents never taught me how to be financially savvy because they weren't most of their lives. They were good later in life, but I was too old by that point. So I wasn't raised with parents who... exactly sat me down, but I was raised with parents who actively and openly talked about how big our house was, how much my mom had to spend to feed us. My mom always, and I do the same thing, we love to be for $15, I have fed 6 adults. Thank you. We're very big on my mom was a coupon mom my whole life. My mom's really savvy with money in that way. She's really good at feeding. She fed and clothed and raised 10 kids on $100,000. Well, eventually, because my dad didn't always make that money. So my dad and mom probably had about 6 kids before my dad started making 6 figures. And we felt pretty good about it. I mean, no, I didn't get name brand clothes, but whatever. I got hand-me-down clothes from my cousins. So I didn't need no monies to buy name brand clothes. But I think first props to her for thinking about it. Like, oh, if we're not financially set, like, obviously I want to help. But also, how do you guys not know what square footage you grew up in? Like, that's so interesting. I also love HGTV. I love houses. So, like, my mom and I, our chill time together is going to see model homes and, like, going to see new homes on the market. So we're very aware of, like, what is the square footage? What tile did you use? What is your counter made out of? Like, we're all about material costs. Like, so this is interesting to me that they don't know, like, have no way to gauge. Like, I want someone to say, I grew up in this home, so I want this home. You know what I mean?
You say like four bedrooms, like yeah. A four bedroom home, something like that.
Yeah.
Okay. And then what about like cars? Would you want to drive a luxury car? Do you not really care about that?
I don't care about cars. I know a lot of people do. Like I drive a Mazda and I'm like perfectly cool. Happy with it. So that's not a big thing to me.
Okay. And then what about vacations? Would you want to travel internationally? Things like that?
Yes. I love traveling. Like I think experiences are like the most like invaluable thing in life. Same, so girl. I would love to be able to travel domestically and internationally.
Mm-hmm. How many square feet would your house be?
Oh, minimum 23.
Okay.
2,300 square feet.
Right, why does she know that?
And how many kids?
So that kind of depends on the person. I would be okay with none. And also, like, it just depends on their values. I would say, ideally, though, my max would be four.
Okay. Oh. What about a car?
I want a car where it's nice and it stays nice. I know, ideally, if you have kids, that's not going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Girl.
But I would, like... Personally, for me, an SUV.
Great.
Cadillac Escalade, you know.
Okay.
The OG, like, mom car of, like, well, back in the day, I would say.
I like okay. her.
And then what about vacations? Do you want to travel internationally? Is travel important to you?
Yes. Travel internationally. I would love to go to Maldives. More tropical environment.
Lifestyle. I've talked to my partner about this because he's from Europe and we've definitely wanted to explore our possibilities of international travel. We've talked about having two kids. I'm already in my mid-30s. So it'd be easier if we had two kids and we could each hold a kid as we travel. But otherwise, I think if we didn't have kids, we'd probably just travel like every 2 years, probably live somewhere new. Maybe have a house we can always come back to, like a ranch or something. But realistically with children, I don't know. My parents and I traveled domestically a lot. Like we did a lot of camping. We did like driving places. My parents took us all the way up and down the coast of California. I felt really like my parents were pretty active with taking us places like that. But like my bestie, she got to travel internationally every summer with her parents. I don't really see a difference value in either option. I think if you're traveling domestic to go camping or to Disneyland or Disney World, that's great. I think if you're traveling every year with your kids international, that's also great. I just don't think it really matters. So I'm pretty open to whatever my partner and I want to do. I'm also really lucky that we're both hermetic, so we're probably always going to just want to stay at home, which is kind of my preference. But at the same time, depending if we have kids, it will change. But that's a really good conversation to have with your partner, just to ask. Like, what is your ideal lifestyle? Do you think we'll be camping and hiking every weekend? God, I hope not. Or do you think we'll be at home snuggling and cuddling to anime?
So house. What's your house? How many square feet?
Shoot, like, I never even thought of this.
How do you all not think about this?
Okay, what about how many kids do you want?
I thought in terms of, like, family, this guy's got to be funny. We need to have inside jokes. Like,
why do I think she was a lesbian?
Kids, I'm probably if we're financially able to, like maybe three kids.
Okay, three kids. So maybe like four bedroom house?
Sure.
Okay, yeah. And what about car? Do you care about a car?
I like my Jeep.
Okay.
Oh, what she looks vacation? Like a Jeep girl.
Do you want to travel internationally? Is that important to you?
I feel like vacations is where I kind of would like to be financially stable enough to do fun things like that. That's cool. And yeah.
I don't care about the square footage of the house. I just want it to have enough space for me and however many kids we have. If we have one kid, we can just have one bedroom for them, like an extra bedroom, so a two-bedroom house. If I have five kids, I want to have a five-bedroom house or a six-bedroom house because we need a bedroom.
So I'll ask you then, how many kids do you want, like ideally?
I want two kids.
Okay. So we'll base the house off the two kids. So you would want like a three bedroom, right? Mm-hmm.
I would want three bedroom, yeah. Maybe like an office added.
Cool.
Same but girl. I don't care about any luxury finishes or whatever.
I don't know why, maybe because of my background, but I do really value and I look for people who don't need much. But I also grew up like pretty middle class, so I do have like a specific standard. Like I don't want to live with counters that will burn a hole through them if I put a hot pot on it. Like I want a counter that has, I don't want to say granite counters, that's got to cost me a lot of money, but I do kind of want counters that I can just put a teapot on and nothing will melt, especially if I have kids, versus growing up. Like my parents really hit home that there were staples they wanted when having children. Tile. So we took out all the carpet in our house, mostly because my brothers had asthma and it helped with their breathing. But also the tile was so much easier to clean if kids spilled something on it. And two was really nice counters. So my parents have very nice counters in their home. They definitely splurge. Now, over the years, as we were growing up, my parents couldn't always afford it. So I grew up with both kinds of counters. But overall, the end result was durability, quality, let it last. So I do think like certain luxury items like granite countertops might be very helpful, even if you're thinking long term, if you can afford it. I definitely don't want to put these things on a credit card. I definitely don't want to take out a loan for reconstruction or remodeling or anything like that. I definitely want to pay for it all out of pocket, which means I might have to live in a fixer-upper for X amount of years before we can afford to upgrade. I'm open to buying a move-in ready home. I'm open to buying a fixer-upper. It's completely dependent on our budget, but I like this girl's vibe the most.
I would want it to be nice. I don't really care about like a swimming pool or anything crazy like that.
Yeah, same.
It doesn't matter if we're super wealthy. I still would want to like be within our means.
Yeah.
Okay. Like within our needs.
Yeah.
Okay. What about a car? Do you care about the car?
I do kind of care about cars. I do like luxury cars. I think they're nice and I think they're sexy. But again, I would never go above. I would never want to be struggling because we're paying a crazy car payment. Oof, it's only based. If we had enough money that we could afford
same
a luxury car. And even same. Then, like, I wouldn't want like a Lamborghini. I personally, I like BMW and Mercedes just because they look nice. But I would get like just a nice car that I could drive my kids around and then my man can drive whatever car he wants. I would definitely like a luxury car.
Okay, so ideally you would like a luxury car. What about vacations? Like, do you want
to? Are luxury cars like $50,000? Because that's what I think luxury is. Like if you're paying more than $45,000 for your car, and it's not like a pickup truck, like a Ford 250 with fucking everything on it. That feels like luxury to me. I think an average car in my head, like a good car, is like $20,000. A cheap car is anything under $20,000. A get me to work and back car is like $2,000. A luxury car is like, ooh, it's got all the like bells and whistles. I'm going to say at least like $40,000, right? Like I want, like there's a certain amount, $40,000, $45,000. Because, like, my Honda CR-V, best car I ever bought, really good for kids, super safe, has 100,000 miles, 2014. I bought it with 3,000 miles on it. No, 30,000 miles on it. 30,000 miles on it. And it was used, and I bought it for 21,000, and it's, like, one of my favorite investments. But it's not a luxury car, right? It's just, like, a normal get places, it's safe for kids car.
I travel internationally. Is travel important to you?
Travel is very important to me. It was ingrained into the way that I grew up. Like I've been traveling, I've been to like 10 countries.
Ooh.
I love traveling, so I want to keep that up.
Okay.
Job that I have or the job that my husband has is going to be some sort of income that is not based off of them working, if that makes sense. Like, oh, I like would want my husband to own passive? A business.
Oh.
I would own a business. And it would be able to run or function without us, and we should be able to.
So, like a passive income business.
Never have to. Were we?
If that was the case, I hope she knows something about that. Like, I hope that she knows something about passive income and bringing in passive income, because that's a really difficult job to have. Not very many people I know who are actually wealthy have passive income. Most of them do work. So that's interesting.
Or we'll always be retired or we're never retired. Either one.
Oh, okay.
So like passive income, I guess, is what that is.
Yeah, I would want to be, that is a goal.
Probably about like 5 bedrooms in the house. You always have to have an extra bedroom. And then the walk-in closet has to be.
Here's the truth though. If you have an extra bedroom, family member is going to be asking to sleep on that in that bedroom. So I kind of feel like, not to send like a negative signal to my family, but sometimes I'm like, stay somewhere else, bitch.
In my bedroom.
So. Right. It might be a little more than 2,000 square feet. What about a car? Do you need a luxury car? What, like, are you okay with regular car?
No, I'm not okay with a regular car. I'm not at all. Care. I love cars. I feel like when you get into it every morning, or you're getting out of work, or you're getting out of work going to your car.
To be fair, I literally never leave my house. Even to do grocery shopping, I hate leaving my house. So I really don't care. I want a car that I can off-road with, because that was a, like, really fun memories I had growing up, was my dad would take us off-roading and camping and dirt biking. So I definitely want a car that's not luxury, because I want it to have mud on it. You know what I'm saying? But I also want a car that's durable and that isn't a junker, mostly because I can afford one that isn't a junker. But you better bet that if I needed to get a junker because I didn't have the money, I would, girl. Ain't no shame. Okay? So I definitely want a car that I can build, like, off-roading memories with my kids. My partner's not much of a camper, but I grew up camping my whole life, so I'm going to get this fucker out of the house, you know?
Are something that you look at and you're like, damn, like, I'm happy I'm working for something good, and that makes me feel good. It makes me happy, so.
So how many kids do you want? You have one right now, correct?
Yes. Okay. So I have one child. I like to have one child. I'm enjoying this. I don't feel like I'm ready for another kid, just because I still view myself as a young person, and I feel like children can be limiting in a lot of ways, especially since I am single. But if I had a partner,
very limiting.
I think I would like to have one to two more children, so three altogether.
Okay.
By the time I'm 32.
Like, that'd be great.
Once I turn 32, I think I'm cool. Like, I'm going to be comfortable with my one child for the rest of my time here.
Okay. So if you did have more kids, you would want them to be before you turn 32?
Yes.
That's what you're saying. Yes. Okay.
Yeah.
So now thinking about, okay, we'll just say maybe you want three kids. We'll go with that for the number. How many square feet would your house be? How many bedrooms would it be, ideally?
If I had three children, though, I would definitely want at least five bedrooms. Because if I had family members that wanted to stay over, I could put them in that room, and then I could have, like, another room
thinking for about hosting
a different purpose, like an office space or, you know, a computer room.
What would you want his income to be if you're going to be a stay-at-home mom? Like, what kind of range would his income be?
That's tough, because I feel like I would have to, like, break down, like, how much it actually, like, costs to have kids and, like,
yes, girl,
the house and all that, and I.
That's what I'm saying. When you all are sitting here making up your dream lifestyles, do you not already think of these things? Like, when I was a little girl, I would take the IKEA book. It would, like, come in, and I would, like, take all the furniture that I wanted, or any home magazine. I would take all of the pieces that I wanted, put it together, and make a budget based off of what I wanted for my life, how many kids I wanted, what school district they'd be in. Like, what I do that now all the time. My partner and I just spent, like, hours the other day looking at different places to rent. How much would it cost? What would we get for the price? What about the square footage? What about the rooms? Could we fit a computer in each room? Like, I'm a very, not that I'm a planner, but I am a thinker, and I want to know the details of this. So I think it's interesting that she just admitted, which is fine, young people, like, she's like, oh, I haven't sat down to really think about it. But that's how you figure out how much you need to make, girl. That's how you figure out what kind of a man you're going to really date. Because if you're dating a teacher, a college professor, depending on their job, they're not going to make enough money to necessarily support or even have the schedule to do all of the things that these people want to do, right? But you wouldn't in your head be like, ew, I'm not dating a teacher. I mean, unless people do say that, that's pretty shitty. Teacher's a great job, but it's a very stressful job and you don't make a lot of money. So you can't, but like, if you're planning to travel to Europe every year, you could date a Cali teacher who makes $100,000 a year at the end of their master's and tenure. But like, you know what I mean? You can't. I'm just saying, I'm surprised, I guess. What about you guys? Do you actually make plans like this? Because I definitely do. I definitely sit down and say, okay, that's why I don't have kids. That's why I have birth control in my freaking arm right now. Because I'm not making enough money, and I make about $80,000 a year to have the lifestyle I want when I have kids. So we're not having kids. We're only going to have kids if we can have the lifestyle we want while having children. Because I don't think, like, there's a God, or I have an obligation to make babies, because I don't think it makes you a bad person if you don't have babies. There is no reason to have children except for selfish reasons. Like, I want to be a mom. I think it'd be great to raise a person. I think it'd be great to, like, adopt somebody, do all this, like, that's great. But that is me making the choice to, like, force someone into existence or take someone away from the life they already have into a new one. So I feel like when I do that, I should be very thoughtful about when and how I do it. And a big part of that thoughtfulness is how much money I'm making and what kind of lifestyle I can provide for my children and for my spouse. So again, when these people are, you know, admitting that they haven't sat down to think about these things, do you really think a man who's got his shit in order to give you this life is going to pick you? You know, I'm always shook when I have callers or I hear women say, like, I want to be a mom, but they've taken none of the steps and preparedness to be that mother. Big part of my mom's responsibilities of being a stay-at-home mom was budgeting the food. Like, do you guys think you're going to marry these men who are already working all the time and then the men still have to figure out how much to spend on food when they're not spending time with their kids? Like, if your husband is at work, he's not going to also be able – he's not going to be doing the cooking. So he's not going to be paying attention to what the kids like, what they eat, what their habits are like. So you're going to have to be the one responsible for curating a budget that – represents your husband's income and then the children's needs. So again, even as a stay-at-home mom, you still need to know these things. You have to know how to budget. You know what I'm saying? So I think it's really interesting that none of these women who have these goals, who probably would want to be married now maybe, don't already know what that looks like. So just like food for thought.
I think for me to be comfortable like staying at home and not working, like... I feel like this is gonna sound bad. I feel like 300,000, like, I guess if they made less than that, I feel like we wouldn't have the lifestyle I wanted, so I would work.
Right.
Oh, you see how my girl, you see how my girl, she's participating in her future. She's a participatory person in her future. She's like actually cognitively thinking. Participation. I like her.
But you're talking ideal lifestyle. Like, yeah, this is, yeah, your dream life, 300K for you to be able to,
I think so,
be a stay-at-home mom.
See, this is what confuses me. If we were all talking about our real dream lives, wouldn't we all be making like 10 milli? Like, if it was a true dream life, wouldn't it be like a lot of monies? Why are we only going for 300,000? Why are we only shooting for 300,000? That's why I don't like these conversations, because like, what is a dream life compared to, like, isn't a dream life like, I'd want $1 billion? Why would you only want 300,000 in a dream life? Right? Like, YouTubers make like more than that. You could just be a successful YouTuber and you, not me. I am not a successful YouTuber. I'm a bad YouTuber. But if you're a real good YouTuber, you make more than that, right? Am I crazy?
And not have three to worry kids about it. And all that. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Like, life's expensive.
I would just like to preface this as saying this is not do or die. But based on where I'm at, if he makes between, like, anywhere from 70 to 100K.
I would have to say 127.
Ooh, very specific.
Ideally, like, if they're in an industry where they do have longevity and they know, like, hey, every single year I'm going to get a raise between, like, 3 to 5%, which, you know, it just depends.
She's
like,
a businesswoman.
I would be comfortable with that.
$500,000? Is that bad? I know that 1% of men make $500,000.
You know, this girl was, I was with her until that number.
Like, less than 1% of men or something.
I'm gonna get red-pilled through this video, aren't I? You know what the thing is? It's like, it's not even about being red-pilled or black-pilled or anything-pilled. It's really about, are you self-aware? I think introspection is so key. I think being self-aware is so important, but it's not necessary. Plenty of people move through their lives perfectly fine without either of those things. But realistically, if you want to be not naive, if you want to be more than just like a pretty face, then you have to understand what $500,000 every 12 months looks like. I worked for a literal cancer doctor. I fucked a surgeon, and no one was making close to that, boo-boos.
Say, probably 150 to a quarter of a million a year. It's my guess.
Okay, and you would contribute also 50-50.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
You'd be willing to do up to
50. What does this girl do for life?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. So, keeping all of this in mind,
I need someone to ask these women what they do for livings. That's what I need to know.
Just painted your ideal life.
Yeah.
For the 27-year-old man, what would his income ideally be? Like, have to be?
What would it have to be?
To support this life.
Which is so funny because I saw this video the other day where it was saying, like, if your wife can spend more than you make, like, you need to make more money. So it really just depends. But, I mean, just to have, like, a really decent lifestyle and you know, be supported well, like, 150 maybe to 250,000 a year would be comfortable for sure. The more the merrier, but that'd be comfortable.
I was just having this conversation with my friend, and she was like, you have to manifest a husband, girl. Like, you have to really think about the lifestyle that you want to live when it comes down to vacations and how many kids you want to have. Mm-hmm. And just like the lifestyle that you want to have. And I feel like ideally my husband needs to be making like 650,000. I feel like there's beauty and growth getting to that point.
Okay.
You know, because at the end of the day,
my dad successfully ran a multi-million dollar business. And if you know anything about business, you put money back into the business. You don't pocket that money, girl. Like, go to any financial channel, go to any, like, listen to them talk. They put that money back into the business. Nobody brings home $650,000 fucking dollars a year unless you're not, let me rephrase, people are bringing that. I think the woman who worked for Planned Parenthood, which is a nonprofit, was bringing home $1 million a year. So yeah, okay, I get it. It happens. But do you know how often these people are working? Do you know what kind of partners they need? Like, okay, I always say this about myself and I'll just say it for myself. I am not what they call a high value woman. Right? I'm not like college educated. I am on OnlyFans. I do YouTube for a living. I'm kind of like high value in terms of maybe, you know, like I've read thousands of books. I have things under my belt that are really interesting, but nothing that could go on a resume. I'm not that kind of person. I don't value materialism. I don't value like existence. I value my existing. I value my view of the world. I value my family and friends. I don't really care about what other people are doing. I don't feel pressure to succeed in a particular way. So, like, I'm not a person, like, who could date a doctor and a doctor could bring me and be like, this is my cool wife. I just be like, hey, what's up, bros? You guys watch One Piece today? Like, you know, I wouldn't be a very suitable wife for somebody who's probably making $650,000 a year unless, you know what I mean? There's, like, a status thing that can come with that depending on the industry. If it's, like, a tech bro, or like a Zuckerberg or something, like maybe, but not even, like different bubbles, bros. That's the thing, different bubbles. Like the Hooters waitress who ends up with like the construction worker in town or the, I don't know, laborer in town. That makes sense in a lot of ways, but that also can move up in different bubbles. You can have the construction worker who make you 250 a year and then the waitress who's bringing in, let's say, 100,000 a year because they're both hustling in high like industries. Because, you know, even food industries, there's like the low and then there's like the high food industry. So like maybe, but see how those are different? I feel like when I hear like I want my person to make 650,000, I'm like, what job is that? What job makes 650,000? Investors? Question mark? Like, girl, you ever even been to Wall Street? Like, I don't know what this girl does for a living, but maybe? Like, that's the thing. Maybe sometimes we defy our stereotypes. Sometimes we do. Like, my sister and I, we were looking at this high-end clothing designer, and we were like, oh my God, if we had money, we would look different. And it's true. If we had money, we would buy different clothes, and we would dress different, but we don't have money. I feel really proud of myself for making 80K a year with a high school diploma. I am incredibly proud of myself. And I work really hard to maintain that income. P.S. sign up for Discord. P.S. sign up for memberships on YouTube. It's $2. Thank you. But like, I feel like I really try to be here. I try to be present. I try to give you guys good content. But I don't have this idea that I'm going to be a millionaire YouTuber. I don't work enough. Those people don't sleep. My friends who make millions of dollars on YouTube do not fucking sleep. And they're stressed and they don't really have time to hang out with their families. And it's a lot. And I don't choose that. I choose my family time over my money. I choose my mental health over my money. I have chronic health issues. I choose my health over my money, which means I won't make as much. If I wanted to make, so if I took like 5 to 10, 15 calls a day First of all, I'd burn out in 2 days. But I could make a lot of money, but still never reach that $650,000 a year. And I charge $250 an hour at my highest price for calls. So again, I don't know what people think they have to do to make money. But like, that's a lot of money.
I'm going to contribute, you know, more than what I'm contributing now.
Yeah.
No, but ideally, I would want someone to be able to match my hustle. So, oh. Like, if I'm making this much and I have this lifestyle, this person cannot have a lesser lifestyle than me otherwise.
So she's not going to date a teacher, basically, which is kind of fucked, but whatever. So wait, does she make $300,000 a year or $650,000 a year? Did I hear that wrong?
It is not going to work out.
Yeah.
So
you said you would want to contribute 40% max. Right. So if they're making $650,000, that would mean you would be making $400,000.
And that sounds great to me, unless I could be making more.
Okay. What do you think is...
What? What do you do for a living? What do you do for a living? Somebody tell me. Like, don't get me wrong. If this girl making $400,000 a year, that's amazing. What is she doing? What is she doing for a living? That's what I'm saying. Also, I don't have this mindset, obviously. Like, I don't care how much my partner is making as long as we come to an agreement that works for the relationship. I literally don't care.
Is the median income for age 31?
As of right now, I think it's probably like between mid-50s, maybe 60.
It's $45,000.
Ooh, really?
Yeah. Ooh. What do you think the top 25% of men are making at 31?
I think it's probably in my range of like that mid, like maybe like 57.
70.
Oh.
By the way, just to like put it into perspective, if I'm making 80 and my partner's making 40, that's not bad. Like, by the way, my partner has no debt and I'm going to have, I should be out of debt by March. That's the goal. So, oh no, that's not right. I'll probably be out of debt by August. Realistically, I'll be out of bad debt by March, what I call bad debt, like medical debt and stuff. I have a lot of medical debt, and then hopefully I'll be out of complete debt, my trailer, by August. So like in my head, I'll be out of debt, and then we live debt free basically is our goal. So our goal is to always live within our means. That's kind of a big part of it. I'm more American, where I racked up a lot of credit card debt when I was in my 20s. Like I had like $30,000 of credit card debt, I think, maybe more, in 2020, and now it's all gone. But it is, now it's like medical bills and stuff like that I have to pay off. So I'm very curious, I guess, how we'll do living within our means. But since he comes from a place where he's always done that his whole life, I'm assuming we'll balance it out pretty well. He's going to heavily help with like budgeting the finances. I'm not a very organized human, if I'm being completely transparent with you. I'm not a person who's very frugal either. All my millionaire friends are like, Brittany, you are not frugal enough. And that's true. I spend a lot of money on food. I went to dinner with my friend who's a multimillionaire. She's in her 70s. She took me to Burger King and we got a dollar menu burger. I was like, girl, why are we not getting $70 sushi right now? And the truth is that like I do. I spend my money on good food. I think I live to eat. And so I'm not eating no Burger King or McDonald's. Like I don't eat fast food. I didn't grow up eating fast food. Funny enough, we were too poor to afford fast food. And now I make too much money to justify eating fast food, especially with like an autoimmune disorder. My diet has become so expensive. My milk went from $2.50 a gallon to $11 to $12 a gallon now I pay. It depends. Sometimes it's as little as $10. But like because I'm on a special diet, like
I don't know, maybe 80.
It's actually $41,000.
You're lying.
For a 27-year-old.
I just feel like everything is so expensive nowadays. Like I guess it, yeah, that's fine. No worries. Cut it in half.
$41,000. Like that's
Shorty will bring it home.
That's the median. And then what do you think the top 25% of men at 27 make?
I guess that's it. Let's change up the perspective. Maybe 60K?
61. Yep, okay. Close. And then what about the top 10%?
Top 10? 75?
91. Okay, so you're under there. And then what do you think the top 1%ers at 27 are making?
Oof, like 200K.
Spot on. 203.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah, awesome.
Yep, so you want a 1% man at 27.
It seems like that's all we want nowadays with these 1%ers.
Median income never eclipses 65,000 regardless of age. So 70 to 100 is above the median.
Well, somebody's gonna have a sugar mama.
not 300,000. I mean, the median, I'm going to guess like, I don't know, is it like 80?
It's $48,000 for 32. Okay. Yeah, and even at even at the top, 35, which was the end of your range.
Yeah.
The median is $52,776.
So my expectations are not realistic.
So you said you want 500K, good for you, girl. But what do you think the median income is for a 30-year-old?
60K, 70K, 50K.
It is $45,000.
Oh my God, really?
Yeah.
This girl shook.
That's the median. Now, what would you guess if you had to the top 25% of men or people at age 30?
Well, if that's the median, then the top 25, like 60?
73. And then what about the top 10% of men?
100?
Close, 108. What about the top 1%? Top 1% of men at 30?
Well, I thought it was 500,000, but you said no. So, 400,000.
338. Yeah, so let's see.
I mean, 338 is still okay.
For a 32-year-old, what do you think the median income is for this age specifically?
For a 42-year-old?
32-year-old.
32-year-old.
The age that you chose.
I'm going to go with probably like 85K a year.
It's $48,000. The top 25% of men, guess how much that is at 32?
Wait, say that once more.
The top 25% at 32 years old.
I don't know. Now I'm even nervous to answer the question. I guess like maybe 125.
77. Top 10% is 120, and the 1%ers at 32.
I'm sorry. There is some sense of joy that I get from watching reality hit people in the face, mostly because, like, all my life, I feel like I've worked really hard. Like, I came from a background where, like, if you wanted a car or a cell phone or anything extra, you had to pay for it. So, of course, we all worked in high school. We all worked out of high school. I've been working since I was, like, 11. I woke up every, you know, summer with my friends, and we woke up at 6 a.m. in the fucking morning to wash cars and mow lawns and pet sit. Like, if we wanted any extra playing cash, we did not get allowances growing up. We had to work for our money. And so I think I've just been so aware. And plus, I'm at the stage now where I've, you know, I've dated, I've lived with partners. I've always made more than all my male partners. I've always made more, you know, in the last few years. My girlfriend, when I dated her in my early 20s, did make more than me. But my partners after that had all been basically men, and I always made more than them. And I didn't even make that much a lot of the time. I just, you know, I was dating within my sort of arena or who was available at the time. And now I'm dating somebody who, you know, I would like somebody who's like less career focused so we can be more family focused. Because the truth is like fathers miss out on time with their children. I don't know if people really understand this, but when you have a working father, he doesn't spend as much time with his kids. So if you have working parents, they don't spend as much time with their families. Now, again, if him and I do not have children, we'll both just like dive into careers. But until then, ideally, after he's done working, you know, and we have kids, he hopefully won't work. Or maybe I won't work and he'll make more money. But we always want to live at that 80K range because we can basically live off of that for the rest of our lives because we're open to living in Europe or here. So we're not beholden to American life standards. We could move to Europe and live a really fabulous life on 80K. So we're really open to it. Plus he's European, so it makes it easier. Like I have that accessibility now. But in America, if I was single, my goal was to make $200,000 so I could have a baby and use $100,000 for us, have an editor who would help me, $50,000 for them, and have a nanny, $50,000 for them, who could help me when my kid was in school. That was just a tentative goal. But now I don't need to think about making that much because I have a partner who can stay home and watch the kids. Now I don't have to pay for a nanny, right? I just have to make it a certain amount that coincides with our lifestyle choices. or he has to make it. Like, we'll work. It's a team effort. No, he's not obligated to not have a job. He's not obligated to have a job. Like, we are obligated to having the lifestyle we want by working together as a team. But again, I have had reality slap me in the face so many times. There have been so many times in my life when I didn't have money in my account, when I was on negative dollars, when I was in shit tons of debt and I paid it all off. Like, it's amazing that I make like 80K now a year, but then in my bubble where I grew up, because I'm not married or have kids, I might like, and I don't have a real job. I have a YouTube job, so I'm not considered successful. But in some places I am. Sometimes my parents are proud of me. Some days they're not proud of me. So I have to just listen to myself. What am I doing in life? What can I get? What is the reality of my lifestyle choice? And I think that that's much healthier than just living in this naive fucking fantasy where you think people are making $500,000 a year. You know what's even crazier is when I worked for that doctor, the single doctor who had a baby, she was making like, I think three something. And I remember her complaining about the housing cost in Seattle because houses were $700,000. And she was like, I can't believe they're making me pay $700,000 for a house, Brittany. As she was paying my salary and she knew how much I made. But she saw me as like nannying wasn't my career, even though I was making like, you know, $1,000 a week or whatever it was. It wasn't a real job to her. So she thought that I would eventually do something else. I think I'm making this assumption a little bit, but the way she talked, which is funny because it's true. I do make more now, obviously, but YouTube isn't a confirmed career. I could lose it tomorrow. What if TOS gets me for some reason and they just decide to terminate my channel? Like, I'm nobody. YouTube wouldn't care if my channel disappeared. And so it is really hard to face that reality of, you know, how much, and to be consistent. What about people who do have good jobs that pay $150,000 a year, but then they get laid off? Like, is nobody considering jobs that you lose? Or what if the market value, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know. I would rather live in a world where reality hits me in the face all the time and I just, like, I'm humbled than live in a world where I think people are making $500,000 a year. You know what I mean?
1%. This is men and women. 1% at 32. 320,000.
I think it's 250,000.
It's 52,000.
What? No, it's not.
She's crazy.
Damn, America.
She's going to get hit the worst with reality.
Guess how much the top 25% is at 35. These are the top 25% of earners.
It's 50.
Sorry, I just want like to, okay. So my partner comes from a world where like you don't have to live off of a lot of money and you can live a really decent life there. And I keep thinking about that reality. Like, he doesn't have, like, if I made 80K where he's from, we'd be like, we'd be doing really good, you know? But like in America, 80K is like, okay. I went on a date with a guy who, you guys know the story. He literally had no job and lived with his mom and said, well, you don't even make that much. You make what, like 80K? And I was like, sir, you make zero. Again, like, what is this world we live in where, like, it's fine. It's fine. I would rather be hit with reality every day and know that I have to really hustle in life to get anything. It's the wild, wild west with iPhones, girls. Okay? Than live in a world where this is crazy. Like, sir, ma'am, people, who do you know who makes this kind of money? Look at the world. Just look at your neighbors and see how much people are getting paid. Look at your military. Look at your teachers. Look at your doctors and see how much they're getting paid. And then do the fucking math. Like, what do you think your partners are going to be doing to make that much money? You're insane. I'm so grateful to just be a middle-class YouTuber. Like, I know this is a job that people think you must make a lot of money doing, but I am very proud of myself for being a middle-class YouTuber, and I would be honored to work this job for the rest of my life making 80K. And that just means I have to be more patient. So, like, maybe I need $12,000 for immigration so I can get married. Okay, I can have that in a year or 2 years. But I will have it. And I understand that, of course, I desire to have more money so I can have it today. But man, if I have to wait 2 years, okay, it's not the worst. It's better than waiting 10 or 15 because I'm making 20K a year. So again, it's like I need to be grateful for what I have. And I hope that these girls walk away from this video being grateful that they could even fantasize for a second that they could date someone who made $650,000 a year, girl.
That $50,000 is a... the average income of a 37-year-old mm-hmm. man.
And then what's the top 25% of a 37-year-old? If you had to guess.
The top 25% of mm-hmm. a 37-year-old man? Dang, maybe it's 200,000.
86.
What? No, it's not.
The top 10% is 137,000. the top 1% of earners at 37 years old. Top 1%ers.
Right,
like,
right.
Like, we're talking 1%, 304,000. Still not 650. Do you think that your standards are unrealistic? Do you think it's realistic? Like, what do you think after hearing
she had better.
The median and the statistics around it? Like, what are your initial thoughts?
It definitely is shocking because a 37-year-old man is a lot older than me. And that means that I don't even know what how to process this right now.
How much does
and
she make?
The median income never eclipses $65,000 regardless of the age.
Wow.
So, yeah, the median income for even a 75-year-old, 16 to 75, never eclipses $65,000. Mm. And then over 70% of men never make $100,000 even once in their lifetime. Over 70%. Mm. In 2021, only 23.4% of the male workforce made $100,000, and that's all ages. So you have to assume a lot of them are older, above 40, 50, 60s. Why do you think, what do you think makes women feel like they want that? Like, what is causing women to want the 1%ers?
I think a lot of it is like social media hype and just this grand idea of what's obtainable nowadays, which it totally is, but you have to work for it. And that's why it's 1% and not everybody's doing it. So it's not bad to want that, but you have to surround yourself with those types of people. So honestly, for a long time, you're probably going to be in the 25%, but that's how you strive and you get better and you meet
I'm sorry, girl, how much you make?
I think they want it because it seems so obtainable based on social media.
Do you think a lot of people just don't know the statistics around it?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, I was a little shocked when, you know, obviously the 1% is going to be that higher income, but what was the beginning? Like 41?
The median is 41.
Yeah, that was as shocking to me, to be honest with you. But I mean, it makes sense.
I'll tell you some other ones that are crazy too. So the median income never eclipses $65,000 regardless of the age.
What?
In 2021 alone, only 23.4% of the male workforce made $100,000. And that's all ages. So you have to assume a lot of them are older too. Like hardly any of them would be 27.
Right, right, right. Wow.
And there's actually only one age from 16 to 75 where the top 10% of men make $200,000. If you had to guess what it is, what would you say?
35,
36.
75 years old.
What? Yeah, bringing it home. Old ballers. That's so cool.
Shit. Would you date a 75-year-old
to
get the money?
No.
So where do you think these guys are at that are making this much money? Like, what do you think they're doing?
Hollywood? To be honest, like, it's probably, I'm thinking, like, as someone that's in, like, the STEM world, they're probably in either STEM, entrepreneurship, or they are in the entertainment industry, and they are the lucky few, I would think. Or they're maybe doing trades.
Okay, and what industry are you in? You're in STEM?
Yeah, I'm in STEM.
Cool. Oh, my gosh.
Yes.
Oh, whoa. That's impressive. So do you meet a lot of men who make this much money? Like, do most of the men you interact with meet these requirements?
Yes, if they're older. If they're outside my age range, yes.
Where do you think these guys are at that are making this much money?
They're honestly probably just not around because they have more going for themselves and just like going out and like partying around. They're probably like strictly businessmen, you know? So I don't know. It's Starbucks at 7 a.m. in the morning. That'd be my guess.
More like 5 a.m. in the morning.
Have you ever met any men that make that much money that are in the age that you're looking for?
Yeah, multiple.
And where do you typically meet them? Like online or on trips?
One I met traveling, one on a dating app, and one or two in person, like out, like going out with my friends. But there are people that do make that are younger. It's just not like the median, right?
Right.
Is that what
you're
saying?
So over 70% of men never make $100,000 in their lifetime. But last year, 23.4% of the male workforce made $100,000. So that was in 2021.
Okay.
So 23.4%.
That's pretty good during a pandemic.
Majority of those are probably older. But there probably is a small percentage that make, you know, over $100,000. But, I mean, you said $300,000, so that's not even anywhere close. But the median income for people never eclipses $65,000 regardless of age.
That's insane.
Would you marry a guy who made less money than you?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. Yes, because at the end of the day, like, you can't, like, that isn't necessarily what makes me, like, attracted to a person. And just because somebody makes X amount of dollars, like, you can't force yourself.
Right.
At least I can't, to like someone for that reason. Mm-hmm. So, like, if whoever I fall in love with or, like, want to be with doesn't make that, then it just... then it is what it is.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you'd be willing to make changes and compromises to your ideal scenario based off of hearing these statistics?
Yeah, because being in your ideal scenario but with the wrong person is going to be miserable. So.
True.
Right, like if the only way you could have that is if the guy's 75 years old, like you're not choosing
no.
that. No. But only if you were, say, at making 500K yourself.
Yeah. If I was making 500K, then I can make that exception, but...
What do you do?
I don't think that I could marry somebody.
What do you do?
That makes less than me.
At the end.
I really think when you come from a privileged world, like all these bitches here and me being born in America, okay, America got its downsides, but it's pretty fucking privileged. We're talking about, look at us, I want a man who makes $500,000 a year. Is that not fucking privilege? Like, who the fuck thinks they're gonna make that much money a year? Like, what? Like, okay, passable income where I come from, 40 to 50. Good income, 65 to like 80 is like, ooh, okay. And then 100 and like 100 and 150 is like, ooh, okay. Like, we doing pretty good. But, like, again, no one's ever reaching 200K. In my bubble, no one was making 200K, not even my dad. Because, again, you're putting that money back into the business. And we're talking about take-home money, right? We're not talking about – my dad obviously made lots more money over the years, but he never – he invested it into the company, which kept it going for a long time. And we learned how to live frugally, but not totally frugally. Because, to be honest with you, our parents did take us out, like – every other Sunday or every Sunday, depending on where our budget was, we'd get to go to sushi or like spend money or go camping. So my parents tried. They couldn't give us name brand shoes. And we didn't have a lot of the luxuries that my friends did. But my family really tried hard to give us group activities. And for us, we're Middle Eastern, food is an event. So if my parents just did a get together every weekend, which they did with my cousins, that felt like we were rich, right? So, and that's pretty privileged. They have enough money to buy lamb, to have enough money to have chicken and beef, to have enough money to have salmon. Like, my parents, you know, at least a time in my life where I do remember having really great get-togethers with my cousins. And that was all of us coming together to share. And all my dad's side is, like, engineers, but they're not college graduate engineers. Like, that's what's so funny is my dad's family came at a time in America where you could become, like, engineers with engineer titles without any educational background. So they did it with, like, high school educations, no problem. And they're all making really good money, like, six figures. But again, that was, like, at a different time. It's different now. I don't know how you become an engineer now. Everyone I talk to goes to engineer, like, college specifically, so I don't know if that's still something you need to do to be an engineer, but at least for my dad's generation, like, it just wasn't that way. And then my mom's generation, they all got high school education, so my mom's family all decided to go to college and do college required jobs and like lawyers and stuff and teachers and things. So it's different. But like my mom and dad's kids, we just had this conversation the other day where my mom's like, why aren't my kids like in like successful careers, like consistent careers? And the truth is that my parents raised us saying, do what you want, be happy, follow your joy, be family focused. Those things mean not making as much money because you're not hustling as much. Even my cousins who have like normal people jobs, they have to work because they want to live in a nice neighborhood and they want to send their kids to good schools and they want to do, and that's great. But, like, I'm not really worried about that. I'm not really worried about my kid going to the best school in the country. Like, you'll make do, bitch. Like, okay, welcome to the wild, wild west, ho. Like, I'm sorry. Like, half of – yes, I want to have a high standard of living for my kid, but I'm never going to be able to afford a high school that costs me $50K a year. Like, what? Like, that's so outrageous, right? But is my kid going to be fed, clothed, and in a good neighborhood? Yes, I can afford that. And they're going to have to like supplement their income or not income, education with other avenues, maybe tutors, maybe they go to a good college, maybe I help them with that. You know what I mean? So I was thinking about it and I was thinking about my brothers. And for some reason, my younger generation brothers, just a couple of them, they think they're like too good to work minimum wage jobs. And I was like, where did this attitude come from? Did it come from the fact that my dad gave them a job out of high school making a lot more money than minimum wage? So they think that's always accessible to them. And maybe it is to some extent, but it really shouldn't be. Like, to some extent, I think your kids should suffer making $7 a fucking hour. So they don't get so big-headed that they think that they're going to marry someone who makes $500,000 or that they're too good to work at Walmart. Like, it's so funny because my parents had 10 kids. The older kids just have totally different values than the younger kids. And I just could never imagine thinking, even right now as a YouTuber, if I ever had to go back to work, yeah, I'd just go work at Walmart or something. Like, what the fuck? It's right there. They'd give me great hours. It's like $15 an hour. That's pretty good. Like, who am I to complain when I'm fucking sitting here begging for a job? Like, you know what I mean? I could never imagine thinking I'm too good to work at Walmart. Like, I don't even know what that means. You know what I mean? But here's my little brother, my youngest little brother. He's like 21. I'm too good to work at Walmart. Says who? Who's too good to work out? Not one person on this planet is too good to work at Walmart. I do not believe this. I do not. So anyways, I do think, like, I hope these women walked away with a better understanding of money. But I'm sorry, why don't they just look at rent prices? That's what, okay. So then I have to assume none of these women live on their own, right? Even this girl, she has a kid. She should know how much things cost. Why is she asking for a partner who makes $650,000? Like, that's what I'm saying. Don't you guys already pay rent? Don't you know how it works in the world? I just talked to one of my callers today, and she said in most places in her area, they want 3 to 4 times the amount of rent in terms of income. I don't even have that. Like, if I wanted to rent a $2,000 place and I needed 4 times the amount of rent, I wouldn't be able to afford that place. Do you know what I'm saying? Like, that's so interesting. Because I only make about, what, like $7,000 maybe a month? And that's before tax. You know what I mean? That's not – I'm not spending $3,000 on rent, y'all. I'm not doing it. I spend $1,900 right now, $2,000. And then for everything totals like $2,500 a month with utilities and internet and stuff, maybe $26,000. But that's everything versus just the base rent being $3,000. I think Destiny – doesn't Destiny always say he's spending like $3,500 or $3,000 for a place in Miami for just the rent? Like, I don't make that much money to justify that kind of a place. Like, I don't, you know what I mean? Beggars can't be choosers. And I just think it's interesting that these girls, like, I assume they must not live on their own because they have to know how much rent is if they live on their own, right?
The amount that I was making was different than I think. Okay, so the higher the amount of money that I would make would determine, like, if I would be willing to marry someone that makes less than me. At the end of the day, I would stay true to who I am. And if this was a person that I really ideally liked and they were just making $50,000,
That'd be so much money.
I would be with that person for sure.
$50,000 is so much money. If you're out of debt and you're making $50,000, like, you could go to rural America and definitely live a good life. You could go to Europe and live a really good life. Like, that's what I... Brittany, they want sports cars and they want, like, yachts or something. Take a deep breath. This is not your bubble. This is someone else's bubble. This is someone else's bubble. This is not my life.
Sure.
Yeah, but as long as he doesn't have more debt than me, that's fine. Like, that's just, like, where we're talking about, like, if you're getting married to somebody, like, their baggage is your baggage. So yeah. You could make less money than me, that's fine, but don't bring more debt than me. You know, that's where it's like, I'm not going to pay your bills that way.
What is it do you think that these men want specifically?
Interesting. So my partner doesn't have any debt. And I do. I have medical debt. I have a credit card bill that needs to be paid off, which I always pay my credit card bills off within 2 months anyways, usually within the day I spend it. But right now, because I'm dealing with like a few other expenses, I'm putting it on the burner for one extra month. So I'm paying that off, and then I'm paying off medical debt, and then I'm paying off my trailer. And he's coming with a little bit of a savings, like a pretty good amount. And he was like, oh, well, like, I can just pay off your debt. And I was like, ah! No. I was like, until we're married, we're not sharing money. We're going 50-50 on everything, you know, whatever, caveat. But ultimately, when we do get married, I should be out of that debt. And that should be a good place to start our marriage. Of course, when we get married, my money is his money and vice versa. But I also don't want him to come into my marriage, our marriage together, paying off my debt. I know that he's more than happy to. And I'm more than willing to let him. But I also don't I want to start off the footing kind of as close to equal as we can. But he also understands, like, you know, it is what it is, right? This is the first year that I will be able to pay off all my debt and really start saving, like truly saving my money. And I'm very excited about that. But this will be the first year. I'm not going to pay any of my brother's bills. I'm not paying anyone's rent anymore. I'm not helping anyone out with anything. I'm putting all my money into my marriage. Because before I would just put it into my family, but now it's into my marriage. And so there will be absolutely a very strict budget coming through. By this time next year, I think I should be in a very good place to really pick and choose where I want to live in modesty. In modesty. But I think I'll be very happy. I would be very happy for the rest of my life if I made 80K. If I could make 80K for the rest of my life, like, I might cry. That would be so lovely. That would be just the best thing in the whole world.
In a woman. Like, what would make a guy, like, pick you or want to be with you if they're making this much money? Like, what are they looking for?
A wallflower. Someone they can come home to and they're making dinner and they're draped in lingerie and
ooh, that's me.
Just unrealistic wife, I guess. Someone who takes the kids to school every day, someone who doesn't complain, and yeah, I'm basically not that, is what I'm trying to get.
Oh, interesting.
So, folks, I'm screwed for that matter.
Just get a job, girl.
And what do you think those guys want? Like, the top 1% men, what are they looking for in women?
I mean, I hope it's just honesty and, like, loyalness, because that's the most hard.
Girl, you just said if he had more debt than you, you're not in it. So, like, you're not even loyal. What does loyal mean?
I guess, like, personality traits to find.
By the way, those really rich men, a lot of them have crazy debt. Like, that's what I'm saying. These very rich people that you're all talking about, they might not have any, like, liquid cash. They might have it all in the business. So, again, never mind. I'm out. My bubble. My spoons are depleting.
Nowadays, and it's, I think, what should be the most important. So, I hope that's what they're looking for. Honestly, though, it's probably fake ass and big titties, which is cool. I turn my head, too. But it's just, I don't think they're as realistic as they should be. I mean, they say the same about us, so.
So, you.
Who's not? Girl.
I think men are unrealistic about maybe what they're looking for, too.
Or they're not as, well, not that they're unrealistic, but that there's such a painted picture of, like, what this woman should look like based on all these women on social media with Facetune and Photoshop and this, that, and the other, that it goes both ways.
But do you think since they're, like, the top 1% of men, they feel like they can be more picky about that kind of stuff?
100%, that they can be a little bit more choosy. I mean, I think core values should always be present. You should always have standards for that. But if it's, like, aesthetics and looks, those 1%ers probably feel, you know, they don't have to talk to you if they don't want to.
And do you think women have unrealistic expectations, too, about men?
Yeah,
specifically, like, in the money category that we're talking about?
Yes,
like,
I mean,
I just asked you to paint, you know, a picture, and it's, like, a $3 million nest egg with the car. So, like, what are your thoughts after hearing the statistics? Like, does that still seem realistic to you, or do you think it's maybe a little
crazy? I mean, it seems realistic to myself because I know what I'm going to get, and I really don't need the support of a guy like that. Like, I'm looking for another pilot, you know what I mean? I don't need a co-pilot. So, it just depends.
What do these women, if this fucking interviewer, God bless her, does not ask these bitches what they do, I'm gonna fucking scream.
Depends on the type of person that you surround yourself with. So I think anything could be realistic. You just have to work for it.
What are these guys looking for in women? Like, what do you think they want in a woman?
So that's why I feel this is the catch with dating someone that's making a significant amount of money. Even though they can provide the lifestyle that I, in a perfect world, ideally would love to have, this is a person that has access to so many more things than the average person has. So I might not be enough for this person's curiosities. You know, and that would make me very insecure in a relationship. It would make me, if I was making significantly less than a partner, it would make me feel insecure, like I wasn't on the same level as them. And Not that I'm trying to like be the, you know, super equal with my partner.
I feel like my partner isn't my competition, right? That's everybody else. So I really don't want to live in a world where like my partner is my competition. I'm not trying to like live up to my partner or my partner live up to me. We're just trying to be a really good team. So if I'm lacking in an area, hopefully he picks up the slack. If he's lacking, hopefully I pick up the slack. But we're definitely like not in competition with one another. I never want him to feel like, oh, I have to make more than Brittany or as much as Brittany. Like the fuck you do, bitch. You need to be a good partner to me and vice versa. And I don't think that means making me your competition.
Because I can be submissive in some areas, I feel like that would just, I couldn't maintain a relationship with a person.
Like you would think maybe that they were looking elsewhere.
I think that men that make this much money just want a woman that's really easygoing.
Well, then why do you want that man?
Probably doesn't have much of an opinion that's different from.
This is what I'm saying. So you laid out this fantasy ideal life, but you didn't think about the kind of man that came with it. And that's the part where it's throwing me. How could your ideal life involve, you know what I mean? Like in, I just don't really get that a lot. Like when I think of my ideal life, I think of one of privacy, quiet, consistent, peaceful, nature, togetherness, love. Like I'm just thinking about like a farm, acreage, quiet, fireplace, like fire pits, cuddling, kids, laughter. I'm not thinking about what kind of car I have. I'm not thinking about what status symbol I have. I'm not thinking about, I'm just thinking about peace. I want peace and fame and money. That ain't no peace.
On their own, I'll never be that woman. I'll always argue, you know, a difference of opinions because it's fun to me. So, I feel like they want a woman that they can be very, what is the word? Like dominant over, like they're gonna be calling the shots. These are all negative things.
Would you be willing to make any changes or compromises to the things that you want based off of hearing the statistics, like the house, how many kids, cars, vacations, you know, living in your nice neighborhood? Like what compromises would you make? Or would you not be willing to make any compromises and this is just the life that you want, end all be all?
I just think at this stage in my life, because I'm 24 and I've dated a few guys, and I still, that's still a goal of mine. Maybe if I was like 30 and, you know, my fertility clock was ticking and I needed to make some compromises to kind of like settle down with somebody.
This is so depressing. I think settling is the worst, but at the same time, not for everyone. Most people, I think, do settle to some extent. I don't know what, just to define settling, I think defining settling is ending up with someone that you're not 100% yourself with. That's what I think settling is. I think settling is ending up with somebody you're not 100% yourself with. And for me, like, I'm not willing to date anyone unless I can be myself 100% of the time. Like, the same person I get to be when I'm alone, I need to be able to be that person in a partnership. And I found it at 33, almost 34. I'm very happy about it. But yeah, like, I don't want to settle just to have babies with somebody. I mean, I'm in a relationship where, like, honestly, I might be too sick to have babies. So even though I want them and I want them so desperately and I can't be with someone who doesn't want babies, I'm also with somebody who loves me for the consciousness that is Brittany. Like, he loves me because I'm me. And I love him because he's him. Like, whatever life we build together is the right one for us. Right? There's no, like, lifestyle before partner. It's partner, then figuring out what lifestyle we want. Obviously, I understand you want to date a partner that reflects a lifestyle you might want. But I'm more of a philosophy lifestyle person, so I needed to find a partner that matched with my philosophy on life more so than my, like, whether or not we have a yacht. Like, who the fuck cares?
Then I would probably be able to do that. But as of right now, that is still a goal of mine, and I think that it's achievable. Because I think that you can live that life with $300,000. Probably not $100,000, but $300,000 probably.
It's very different when you're expecting someone else to do it for you versus like, I'm gonna do it myself. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, whoever I'm with mm-hmm. will hopefully have a similar mindset and mm-hmm. be able to like work towards it with me and we can kind of tackle it together.
Right. Yeah, it's like if you have 20K and I have 20K, like we can get so much more done as opposed to myself or yourself or me just demanding that you have that. It would never work mm-hmm. for me.
Yeah, no, I'm not too fixated on the salary. I still want to be comfortable and hopefully have some of the things that I wasn't able to have, you know, go on trips and have kids and have them well taken care of.
Fair.
So whatever that means, it's a cliche saying, but like my best friend growing up, she came from a family of 8, also a blended family like mine. And her mom always said, you always make things work. So I'm like actually not even worried about it because I think if you just think that I'm going to make it work, we're going to make it work.
And overall, just to round out this video, would you say that you're surprised by the statistics I showed you, like the median income of the 31-year-old only being, let me look really quick, $45,000?
Oh, yeah. I'm shocked. But then again, like, I understand it. Now that I think back of, like, different conversations I've had with people, different dates that I've run
on. Oh, good. Okay.
Like, that does make a lot of sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But at the same time, it's also kind of nerve-wracking because if I'm thinking like, you know, back in the day, like if you would have thought like in high school, like, hey, you know, once I'm 30, you know, everyone thought like, oh, at least for girls, like we're going to be married, you know, we're going to have kids, we're going to be living in this big house. And that's not even like the standard of living currently or even like the average. So yeah, like that's insane to think about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's crazy when you have an idea of what you want, but you don't really know what it is you're asking for.
Yeah, like, you don't know the true value of things until like you're currently experiencing it.
Yes.
I think just surprised, honestly, because I wouldn't have guessed that. So it's good to know what is more realistic.
I'm definitely shocked, to say the least, especially for me picking 27. I wonder if maybe I would have picked a little bit of an older age. But it just wasn't ideal for where they would be at. But you said people don't even eclipse over 61,000.
65,000
over their life. That's just like
for the median, yeah.
Yeah, for the average of people, it's mm-hmm. interesting. So I mean, I guess it really just depends on what you do for a living. It was a huge takeaway for me. I mm-hmm. would have never guessed that number.
Yeah, because even if you go to 30, it's 45,000. 35, 52,000.
Wow.
And when you're a woman who's making, you know, a good amount yourself, it's like you don't even think about a man making less than you. I think it's the mindset that a lot of women have.
I don't know, for myself, because I at a young age just figured out like the type of people to be around and how to invest and turn more money into money and things of that nature. So to know that a lot of people work really hard and never get there is like sad.
My conclusion is that these questions that you asked me are very important factors in, you know, having a relationship with someone and having a happy, comfortable marriage, having realistic expectations in your life and with a partner, you know, or being in a situation where you're settling, you know, with a partner. It just brings up all those different things. I guess my takeaway from this is that I probably should be studying, you know, different jobs that these men can have because I need to change. Maybe if I really want to find my ideal husband, I need to change, you know, what rooms I'm showing up in.
All right, guys, that is all I have for this video. If you liked it or found it helpful, be sure to give it a thumbs up.
Wait, do you really not have a video asking them how much they make? Oh, this is the latest video she has up. Well, Courtney Ryan, that was a really cool... It was a cool video. I'll subscribe. But I really would like to see like how much these women make. Because I... Oops, that's me. I just turned me off. I genuinely don't understand like the mindset they're in. I don't have it. Like I said, I grew up with a dad who worked and owned a business. I grew up with a mom who helped part-time and now works full-time with him. They don't make that much money. Like, that's not how businesses work. That's not how income works, at least not in my bubble. So I am curious about a few things. I'm curious about what these women do for a living, where they say like, oh, my man needs to match me or not make less than me. What does that mean? I would like to see sort of realistic goals put forth. Even I'm an unrealistic dreamer. My partner is always like, Brittany, we're not going to make that much. And it's true because I'm not going to be energetic enough to make as much as I would like. Like, I have this dream fantasy of making like 20K a month and maybe in passive income, maybe one day. But honestly, if I really wanted to do the YouTube hustle game, I probably could, but I would have to make it a lot more PG. I would lose my niche audience. It wouldn't be worth the investment just for the money. I really value my audience. I value our adult conversation. I value our philosophy conversations. I value my Discord. I value it's 18 plus. I value that I'm talking to adults. I don't want to appeal to children. I don't want to make myself more PG. My whole channel is age restricted to 18. Like, I don't want... I like the people that I'm talking to. If I could get more people, that's great. But that still doesn't mean I have the spoons to do calls where I make most of my money. So like on AdSense, I make about $500 a month. Memberships and super chats super help. But the most help actually comes through Patreon or through just joining the Discord at $10 a month makes a total difference. Like, I would rather have 1,000 people join my Discord at $10 a month than have 5 or 6 people who pay $5K a month to talk to me. Like, I would rather just keep prices low for everyone and have more people who want to come chill, you know, but that's not always what's going to happen. I don't really advertise a lot. And I understand that if I did, things would move up. I just don't have the energy. If I'm being honest with you, I barely have the energy to do this podcast today. I am physically in so much pain. And I'm so lucky that my chronic issues happened in my 30s when I was established, because if I had this shit when I was in my 20s, I don't know what I would do. It was hard enough having a mental illness. It was hard enough having borderline and PTSD. That was really difficult working all the time with those things. But I honestly think this chronic pain stuff is the worst, the worst. But thank God I'm not suicidal anymore, so it's easier for me to make money now. Like, I'm super aware that mental illness makes doing the basics really hard. Everyone has a different version of what the basics are, because I also believe that we're evolved animals over time on a planet, and because I also believe we're in the wild, wild west and we're really lucky when people help us, it's my job to still do the best I can with what I have. It's still my responsibility to feed myself. It's still my responsibility to build good communities. It's still my responsibility at the end of the day to choose good partners. And so ultimately, I do rely on myself at the end of the day. I cannot wait for a partner. I cannot dream of a partner who makes lots of money. I cannot put my life on hold. And I'm really lucky that I've met someone that I want to commit myself to, that I want to be married to, who supplies me with so much more than money, right? Because, like, I didn't need a man for his money in the first place. I needed somebody who was kind, compassionate, patient, and understanding. I needed somebody who could be at home and be present in our children's lives. I needed someone who could hold me while my body ached or while my mental illness was getting to me. I needed somebody who would be willing to educate himself on my conditions to really help me with my life, right? I need somebody who's a team player. I don't need somebody who's busy feeding their ego, who's busy making $1 million a year and bragging about it on social media. I don't need someone who's chronically cheating on me. I need someone who loves me for me and is understanding what they're signing up for when dating me, which is hopefully a future in which we have a peaceful life. My life is pretty peaceful right now. It's pretty good. Like, minus my chronic issues, my literal existing is quite good. And I worked really hard to get here. And so for me, that's always about maintaining the basics. Maintaining income, so I'm not exactly living paycheck to paycheck. Saving up to do procedures I need. I need $3,000 to do my cavities right now. I have cavities because I was way too poor in my 20s to ever afford dentistry, ever. But now I need to save, and I probably won't get them done till like May, but I will be able to save up for it, which is really nice. Like, I think it's really nice that I can save up $3,000 while still maintaining all my other goals. Because again, we have to pay for immigration. We have to pay for the wedding paperwork. Like, even the legal wedding, it costs money. Like, it doesn't matter that we're not doing anything. It doesn't matter that I'm not having a wedding. What matters is that everything will cost something. I did splurge on a dress from one of my favorite designers. I've wanted to buy from her for a really long time. I'll have a whole wedding video out about it after we get married. But yeah, like, stuff like that, I did save up to, like, you know, spend $800 on a wedding dress, which for me is the most expensive thing I've ever bought myself, ever. That was, like, a really big deal. Like, a really big deal. So again, I don't know how you live your life. I don't know what bubble you're in. But when we're talking about expectations, I think it's really important to be realistic about them. For your own sense of peace, again, this is about maintaining peace. Expectations, when they, you know, when you overpromise your brain, it feels like abandonment, at least to somebody like me. So I told my partner from day one, do not overpromise to me and I'll never be upset, basically, because overpromising feels like lying. Oh my gosh, I'm going to make this much money. Oh my gosh, I'm going to do these things, but you never do. It's like, please just be honest with me with what you're capable of so we can make our life perfect. I don't care if you make 20K. I don't care if you make zero. I don't care if you make 2 million. If we do not have a sense of peace, if you are not present in my child's life, if you are not coming home and sleeping with me every night and holding me and I'm holding you, what's the point of being married? Like, what is the perk of cohabitation if we are not creating a team-like situation where, like, it is us against the world and we are striving for peace? Again, that's just my bubble. That's what I want. I want a sense of peace in my life. And I think I have it. I think I'm going to continue to have it. I think I've chosen a partner that will facilitate that peace. I don't know that a partner who makes a lot of money will actually facilitate peace. From what I've seen, not so much. But maybe I could be wrong. All right, guys. Thank you for watching. Thanks to my partner for suggesting this video. Genuinely, at the end of the day, you get to decide what life you want. And I think these women hopefully walked away with a really great lesson learned. Fingers crossed. All right. Please leave your comments in the sections down below. Let me know your thoughts. I really want to hear them. Truly, this video had me shook. All right. I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye. Okay. Let's talk about my hair. Oh, let's talk about my hair. So, okay. I straightened my hair. My brother Mark, the gay, he wanted me to straighten it to see how it looked. So here's the problem with my hair. It's very long, right? But you can tell I definitely have curly hair that I straightened, or I have all these like frizz ends. I don't like straightening my hair usually because I think it just doesn't keep it healthy. And there's a lot of consequences to straightening hair and chemically straightening your hair that's coming out, like all the women who are getting cancer. So I definitely, you know, used to hate my hair when I was a kid and I always wanted it straight. You know, I grew up with like the 90s, 2000s fashion and I used to cry because I had curly hair. And my mom used to tell me, I'm not like chemically straightening your hair. You're going to regret it. And I used to hate my mom for like not doing it. And now I miss my curly hair. I've had it like this for like a day. And I miss my hair. I miss the Brittany that I am when I have curly hair. But, you know, I appreciate this Brittany too. Here, I'll show you the back as well. It's definitely not cut for curly hair or straight hair. Here. Can you guys see? Hopefully you can see. You can see like it's really frizzy. You know, so you can see it's obviously like not the healthiest looking or not the prettiest, but when my hair is curly, it's gorge, you know. So this was fun. I'm glad I did it, but I definitely miss my curly hair. All right. Hair talk, love it. All right, talk to you guys soon. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while I'm in bed, my belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine, not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed, so why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking, yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth, and living life as a fool. Dun, 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 dun.